when you're in a beautiful city. Many of us are coming to a climate that is so foreign to their winter existence. We're getting more snow in Boston as we speak. It's been a very long winter, so thank you for coming back. We're back here for a question that pervades throughout labor floors and between individuals within anesthesia groups. And it's this question about when you have a wet tap, what exactly should you do? Should you advance the epidural catheter and use it as a continuous spinal catheter? Or should you make that attempt to resite the catheter in hopes of getting a well-performing epidural anesthetic? And with us are two individuals, myself from Boston, and I'm going to be countermanding the ideas of my colleague, Kenneth Nelson at Wake Forest. We both have very similar backgrounds, except to say that perhaps one individual might be the more kind individual, thoughtful of the patient, and the other might be a risk taker, someone that embraces risk as a way of life. When they ask how hot chili peppers do you like to eat, he gets the magnitude, you know, off the Richter scale. And when you think about whose advice you want to follow, perhaps you want to follow the side that's a little bit more caring and concerned about your patients, about how you're doing, and how things are going overall. So just as a show of hands, could I see how many people, if their partner gets a wet tap and you just happen to be standing there, if you encourage them to thread the catheter in and do a spinal, continuous spinal catheter? Okay. And clearly that's a side that also likes apple pie, justice, humanity, that sort of thing. And if I could see the other side, I guess, the people that say, no, you should recite, okay. So there are some individuals that we'll need to engage in a conversation about, and this is the conversation that we're gonna have right now. And I must say, as you go along, if you think of some questions, please feel free to write them down. We'll be answering those in the panel discussion as well. I think this is an area of a lot of interest and a lot of controversy. So I bring it to a routine day on the labor floor. And you have a 30-year-old parturient that's in front of you. She's a labor and delivery nurse, which is perhaps a risk factor, maybe for what you want to do to this particular individual. I don't know. And she has Bynes processes that are most palpable. She can lean forward. She follows directions. She is the perfect model of being seated in the correct position because that's what she helps other patients do. And you try a L4-5 and you get a wet tap. You try a L4-5, we change the angle a little bit, another wet tap. So you're thinking, gosh, man, what'd I do? I'll just go on to another level. Wet tap city. Finally, move to L2-3, and here you get an epidural catheter, okay? Now, this might sound like something out of a horror story, a Wes Craven novel, a zombie movie that we don't want to think about. And the anesthesiologist, the husband, turns to you and says, what's going on here? What's, happening on your end of the world? And you reply, well, we're getting here comfortable now. It's going to be okay. Everything's going to be all right. Now, what's kind of interesting is that this is the story of the birth of my first child. I was the anesthesiologist looking at my colleague who was an attending on our service and someone I trust implicitly. And this was his experience in dealing with my wife. And thankfully, after many promises and my doing the epidural blood patch and my agreeing to do all the subsequent epidurals for all the subsequent kids, we have three kids now. And this could have been our only child because I must say the experience for my wife was just horrendous. If you think about postdural puncture headaches, she was a classic definition of a postdural puncture headache. I mean, I had to carry her around the house and it was just horrible. So if you were to follow the advice of yourself and that good, better angel on your shoulder that's saying, after the first wet tap, to go ahead and insert a spinal catheter, perhaps that's going to be something that's going to lead you into less trouble than not. Now, we must say that the epidural technique, we understand why wet taps occur. It's a difficult skill. We can surmise to say that in our anesthesia training, it is the most difficult technical skill to master. And that's been demonstrated in a lot of different studies. Moreover, when you think about the pregnant woman and her space, her epidural space, it's full of more lax tissues. It has a lot of engorgement. There's movement of just the body during with contractions. And you can see how a wet tap can occur. And if you look in the literature, they say the incidence is up to about 6 to 7%. And indeed, we recognize that happens to even gifted individuals that have done thousands and thousands of epidurals in their past, as my attending colleague who experienced. And so when you have that wet tap, there's a couple ways that we can approach this. Certainly, we can move up in one direction towards that spinal catheter, threading it, using it, being thoughtful about it. We can also thread or try to do an epidural catheter at another site. There are going to be forces here that tell you that one way or one mechanism is a better way to go. And he who shall not be named will be trying to encourage you to do the other process. Okay. So let me tell you about 10 things. 10 advantages of why you want to thread that spinal catheter. Okay. And the first has to do simplistically with where we get better analgesia or anesthesia. When we think of a cesarean delivery and whether we do an elective epidural or if we want to do a spinal anesthetic technique, we think of the many ways that one contributes to a better anesthetic experience. And when we look at epidurals, we understand that sometimes the conformation is not there. We're actually not in the epidural space. We understand that the quality can sometimes be patchy. People have these windows that we can't seem to get comfortable. And as such, that can oftentimes result in a replacement. And you compare it against spinal anesthetics, and I've added just catheters, but this is just spinal anesthetics or techniques in general. We have that confirmatory method of looking at that CSF. We can understand that it works very quickly, that it has a limited failure rate, much less so than an epidural anesthetic, and also that we can tailor it to what we want. So if we can use initially just opioids during labor analgesia, have a very nice experience with very minimal motor blockade, and we can transition all the way up to a combination of the local anesthetic and the opioid. So there are some benefits. And in our own institution, and I'll try to give you some tips along the way, what we utilize is our same infusion dose as we would with epidurals. We just aspirate off 2 cc's of this. We give that initially to establish initial analgesia, and then we set the pump to 1 to 2 milliliters per hour, and that keeps our parturients quite comfortable. We've had tremendous success in utilizing this technique, and we take away the patient-controlled element of the pump. So it's just a continuous infusion with this infusion rate. The second advantage, however, is the safety record. Most people don't recognize that we've been traversing into the spinal space for a very long time with continuous techniques. In fact, in 1907, they used to have a malleable silver needle that they would place intradurally, and they would do continuous spinal anesthetics for different types of surgeries. Dean reported that, and then Tui used a ureteral catheter as a method of getting into the dural sac and providing continuous spinal anesthesia. And we've used this all throughout until 1960s, 1970s, 1980s. We started experimenting with the microcatheters. And my own institution, Ron Hurley, was one of the lead proponents of microcatheters. And with that, we tried it, we utilized it, not so much during labor, but certainly in non-labor situations, and it worked quite well. But as we recognize in the 1990s, after some reports of Cotta Aquinas syndrome, and mostly this was because of maldistribution. The fact that people had these microcatheters that were being utilized, they dosed them, it didn't give them the level they wanted, they dosed some more, added more dosing, and finally they had toxic levels of local anesthetics in the space. This hasn't really been reported with macrocatheters. However, there has been some device exemptions. There have been some additional studies with even the microcatheters, and these have been demonstrated by Valerie Kusch and others that this is a wonderful way to provide spinal analgesia or anesthesia. And if you think about the European experience, Europeans have been using microcatheters since the 1980s. They still have them in their regimen. They use them on a routine and regular basis every single day, and they have great success with them. So it was just the way that we handled those catheters that resulted in some of the problems. But if you look at spinal catheters in general, the macro ones that have been used up in the preceding 60 years, there was no real issue. And if you look more recently than that, if you take a look at 2000 and beyond, using just the epidural catheter threaded into the epidural, into the spinal space, Reuter was described their case where they had just one high block. Vandeveld did his nice report where they had no episodes of high block or other sort of complications using this mode of analgesia. We're preparing a report right now that we hope to seek publication for with 159 cases over a period of 3 years where we've had no complications with threading in that epidural catheter. And if you look at the SCORE project, which is a registry of complications that's been hosted by SOAP, conducted at Wake Forest by Robert D'Angelo and others, you see that they've had a number of spinal catheters reported, but vanishingly small sort of problems with those spinal catheters and their use, and no reports of high blocks with that registry. So it's quite interesting that even though we have many reports and many thoughts about spinal catheters and how bad they could be, there in fact the safety profile is very good. Now, in fact, I would submit that their safety profile might be better than looking at other sorts of options, in part because of the safety steps that we apply. And at our own institution, what we do is we label the catheter as a spinal catheter. We put a sign on the door. We put a sign over the labor record. We tell the patient and the nurse and the obstetrician that it's a special catheter, it's a spinal catheter, and to sort of treat it with respect. And we've had no issues with that. And that's one safety mechanism that we use. But it's, in fact, probably safer in the fact that it reduces some of the complications that we might otherwise see. This interesting report by Heeson was a meta-analysis of the studies that have looked at spinal catheters, some versus epidural catheters. And what they found was that overall, with the spinal catheters in place, there was a reduced postdural puncture headache sort of analysis. And this is what's called a Forrest-Whitaker plot. Line of unity means that there's no difference. That's the line that goes down the middle. And you'll see that there's an advantage for the spinal catheters versus not managing the case with the spinal catheter. Now, I'll say that the tip of that red bar does cross that line of unity. So some might argue that it's not completely statistically significant, but most would argue that there's at least a direction or a trend. And certainly, if you read the reports, they'll say, even if the incidence is not reduced or not reduced significantly, at least the severity of headache is reduced when you thread in that catheter. And that reduction may be in part because you're not creating that second, that third, that fourth wet tap when you reapproach a space looking for an epidural location. With this idea of lower postdural puncture headaches, we also have lower use of blood patches, and this is significant. This is a significant difference when analyzed by all these different records, and we can indicate that is a real advantage of threading in that spinal catheter. Because with the epidural blood patches, we also know and we recognize, and we had a discussion just this morning about the very fact that when you're doing an epidural blood patch, it's possible that you might get another wet tap. There might be something intrinsically wrong about that specific space that you're trying to go in, and perhaps that will lead to another wet tap, and then that kind of resets the clock for everybody. Okay. Now, we'll switch over to those that want to still maintain the epidural space and look for another epidural location. Some thoughts to consider, and we'll talk about five different thoughts, and beginning with the first one, is consider the difficulty that you might employ when you engage in a different space. And this nice study by Ian Russell from the UK looked at the randomization of individuals to either managing them with a spinal catheter or looking for another epidural location. And what they found was in four of the cases, so they had just the spinal catheter and they misread the research results, and so they just managed them as spinal catheter. In another group of patients, so four individuals, they got another wet tap. And then in another group of patients, when they're going for their fourth attempt at locating the epidural space, they had a failure to achieve any anesthesia or analgesia, and so the patient delivered with in discomfort. So when you think about all these different options, the fact that you might have to create another wet tap might be a possibility, or that you might not be able to locate an epidural space that's satisfactory. These are some of the options that are available to you that unfortunately do occur when you try to look for another epidural space. And in thinking about that, and thinking about the risk of a dural puncture, we have to think about this somewhat statistically, because the risk is not just additive, it's not just that rough 6% incidence. If you look at the ways that statistics tell us to look at the question, the risk is actually cumulative, meaning that if you do the first attempt, your risk of a wet tap is roughly 6%. If you do a second attempt at another level after you've done a wet tap, the chances of a wet tap increase to about 11%, and indeed that's what Reuter found as well as Ian Russell found in their studies. If you try a third attempt, your chances of a wet tap go up to about 17%. And finally, if you try that fourth attempt, it moves up to about 22%, your chances of having a wet tap. So it's pretty interesting that every subsequent attempt, you magnify the risk of a wet tap occurring, and that's something that you want to try to reduce. So in terms of looking at that epidural space, we have to consider how we should approach it, whether our risks are the same, and I would submit that they're actually increased. And there may be something wrong about that epidural space that makes it more difficult, which would only magnify these risks even higher. Okay. A seventh reason is to avoid the confusion of epidural dosing. So in the situation that occurs, you have an epidural needle that moves into the epidural space. Whoops, we've actually gone too far. Gotta pull it back. And this is our Seldinger approach to the epidural space. Now we can just thread the catheter and marry a hoe and dose the catheter. But even if you approach it at a different level, you've created that dural puncture. That dural puncture is a communication between the epidural space and the spinal space. And as such, you're going to have some issues with that. How do I know you're going to have issues with that? Well, I can show you some results, but as you fill up the epidural space, some of that is going to translocate through the hole that you've created. And the evidence that I present for that is first an older study by Suzuki done in 96. And Suzuki and colleagues were a group of Japanese investigators. They were trying to do a technique, epidural technique, and in 40 patients, but in half the patients, they thought, gosh, we think we've seen that when there's been a dural nick, that the epidural seems to set up faster. So why don't we study that by doing a 26-gauge puncture in half the patients after we've done the epidural. So similar to a combined spinal epidural. So you put the epidural needle in, you follow up with 26-gauge puncture, you puncture the dura, and then you thread in the epidural catheter and you use it. And they compared it to just the other approach where they just did a standard epidural technique. And what they found was faster sacral spread and faster onset of the block. Now, John Thomas was one of our fellows. We designed a similar study looking at that very question. He moved down to Wake Forest where they used 27-gauge needles, and they didn't find a difference when you used 27-gauge needles. Now, I thought this would be a phenomenon related to the needle size, so we repeated the study with our standard needle of choice, and what we did was we randomized 80 women. 40 women had the dural puncture epidural. 40 women had a regular epidural technique. And just with that 25-gauge puncture, what we were able to demonstrate was faster onset of the block, better sacral coverage, better bilateral coverage out of that small 25-gauge hole. Now, when you think about it, if you're moving with a 17, 18, 19-gauge hole, you're going to have a lot of transflux through that. And even though with the 25-gauge, we didn't see any higher sensory levels, I would submit with a 17-gauge puncture or an 18 or a 19-gauge puncture, you're probably going to have problems with high blocks. And in fact, the question then is posed, if you're going to dose after you've created this wet tap, you've secured an epidural at another location, what are you going to use for your initial dose? And if you have a stat section, are you going to handle that catheter differently? And it's those questions where there's some doubt in the mind and doubt between how you manage it, but maybe even how your partner manages when they call the stat section on his or her shift. I mean, that doubt is a very difficult thing and a difficult sort of proposal, difficult situation to deal with. And in fact, high blocks do occur, and they principally occur after epidurals. This is the analysis of close claim studies by the ASA. If you look at maternal deaths resulting from a high block, most of them came after an epidural, and more specifically, after a resited epidural catheter. So they've had a wet tap. Because they've had a wet tap, they resited. They dosed catheter, went up too high, and as a result, they had a maternal death. So something definitely to think about. Proposal number 9 is that the spinal catheter leads to less litigation. And this is the claims analysis from the National Health Service over in the UK. They've evaluated both epidural management and spinal management. And you can see in terms of nerve damage, inadequate blocks, even the high blocks that we mentioned, these are much more common in the epidural situation than they are in spinal. And we just said that they're probably more likely after a dural puncture has been created, a communication between the epidural and the spinal space. And finally, spinal catheter and the use of spinal catheters is now part of the popular practice. It's something that's being accepted and managed more readily, in part because people have experience with it, labor floors have experience with it, and it's something that you should consider having experience with as well. In the UK, now about 50% of the units now manage this very scenario of wet tap with introducing that catheter and using it as a spinal catheter. And that's more common, especially if they discover that it's a spinal catheter while using labor management. Here in the United States, looking at Curtis Basinger's work from a SOAP study that was done in 2008, we can find that there is a wide range of use of spinal catheters. However, if you spend more of your time on the obstetrics floor as a percentage of your practice, you'll find that people have much more comfort with the idea of a spinal catheter. In fact, that's the same as the Australian experience. The more time that you spend on the obstetrics service, the more comfort you have with this type of management, in part because we recognize that it works so well. In contrast, what's kind of interesting is that there's an inverse relationship to the number of years you've been in practice. So it might be an interesting sort of discussion of whether some of the people that still maintain that they resite at another epidural space, how long they've been in practice. Because if you've been in practice for less than 10 years, you're more likely, 50% likely, to use a spinal catheter. As you progress among the years, you get less likely to utilize the spinal catheter. And that's the same as the Australian experience as well. So what does that say about sort of the way that different techniques get fossilized into our way of practice? I don't know, but maybe it is an embrace of a new technique that should be embraced uniformly. So how can we summarize this overall in terms of making that sort of concerted effort to think about spinal catheters? I'd say the first four, in terms of improved analgesia or anesthesia, long safety record, reduced incidence of postdural puncture headache, reduced incidences of blood patch, those are all positive attributes of a spinal. The second five are sort of difficulties with resiting the epidural. The fact that you might have problems even finding the epidural space as you engage in it at different locations, you might risk that dural puncture. You might have confusion with how much you're going to dose it, both now and in the future. You have that higher incidence of high spinals, and also the litigation concerns that are out there. And finally, it is becoming an accepted practice. It's something that we should sort of engage in. So when you think about this issue of wet tap, think about the advantages of spinal catheter. Think about the disadvantages of the epidural catheter. And think about who's leading you in this discussion and what type of person they are and what type of risk they like to employ in their daily life. And with that, perfect introduction for Kenneth Nelson, who'll take the other side of the discussion. Thank you.